Good morning to you and welcome to one of my favourite spots in Punta Dawe and by the lake here in the plantation in Glanrhyd. Welcome to our harvest service. 2020 has been a difficult year and I hope and pray that this service will remind you of all the reasons to be thankful and grateful to our God. Around me I can see the autumn colours, I can see the beauty of creation. And hopefully this message and today's service will encourage you and remind you that we have a good and faithful God. We have a God who is great. And so let's open our service with our first hymn, How Great Thou Art.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees, when I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. great thou art, how great thou
art. Yes, this is so true, isn't it? Our God is great, he is wonderful, he is good and faithful. We can trust him in every situation. Just to give you an idea of what to expect in this service, we're going to have a children's message, and the children have produced little videos themselves. They've been memorising Psalm 100 over the last few weeks, and they've been shouting to the Lord and coming before him with joyful songs, because he indeed is the God who made us. And so there's going to be a children's message. There's going to be a special song by the Sandry family, a prayer, a reading, and then the message will be in two parts today, based on Luke 17. Okay, so that's today's service, and we pray and hope that it will be a blessing to you. Now I'm going to hand over to Kath and to the children for their videos.
Hi everyone, hope you're all okay, and I hope you made good use of last week to really learn the verses that we've gone over in Psalm 100 so far. Now, as you already know, this week we're thinking about harvest, and our verses from Psalm 100 suit this week so well. They're all about giving thanks to God, and Henry's going to read them to us.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Sometimes it's really good for us to stop and think about all the different things that God gives us. And here are a few people to help you do that.
Thank you, God, for my home.
Thank you for family.
Thank you for school.
Thank you, God, for our clean water every day.
Thank you for languages and culture. Diolch am ieithoedd a diwylliant.
Thank you for the outdoors.
Thank you for friends.
Thank you for my food.
Wow, thanks for that amazing list of things that are part of our lives every day. They're just there, we don't really think about them, but we're so grateful for them, and it's really important for us to stop and give thanks for these amazing things. And at this time of year, you might hear lots about giving thanks, and that's a really, really good thing. It is really important to stop, and it's important to stop and give thanks to the people who help us every day. And lots of people are talking about that with coronavirus at the moment, all the amazing different people who are helping us to get through and are helping us to stay healthy and are helping us in so many different ways. It's really, really important to give thanks to them, and not just to think it, but to say it out loud. Think of someone today who helps you often, and go and say thank you to them. It's a really important thing. Now, this psalm is talking about giving thanks out loud to someone else, isn't it? Not just saying thanks into the air, or not even saying thanks to someone who has helped you in your family or in a hospital. This psalm is talking about saying thanks to God, because really it's from God that all these good things come. And this psalmist wants us to come and give thanks to God. He tells us to enter his gates and his courts. And that's just another way of saying come to God, because we're God's children, because Jesus has taken away our sin. You don't have to be afraid. You can come to God with your thanks, and you can come to God with your praise. The psalmist has already talked about this, about coming and just saying to God, you're wonderful, you're amazing. If the gifts that you give are this good, are so wonderful, it must mean that God is even more wonderful and amazing. And so this is a really lovely opportunity for us to stop and maybe make a list of all the things in our lives that we should be grateful for, that we should give thanks to go and say thank you to someone nearby who actually maybe helps us to enjoy those things, the person who keeps our home tidy, or who cooks our food, or who teaches us, or who has helped us in a hospital to stay healthy and well. But let's not forget to give thanks to God, the one who is the one who gives all these good things, the one who all these good things comes from, the one who pours out good gifts on our lives, and who shows us through doing that he loves us, and that he himself is more wonderful than all these things that we can give thanks for at harvest time. Next week, we'll be hearing about an even more amazing reason why we can come full of thanks and praise to our amazing God.
Shout for joy to the Lord, the Holy.
Worship the Lord with gladness.
Come before him with joyful songs.
Know that the Lord is God, it is he who made us.
We are his people and the sheep of his pasture.
Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Thank you, children, for those videos. Yes, our God is good, and we thank him for all his good gifts to us. And later on, we'll be hearing some other reasons to worship our Lord with gladness. As part of the service in the church building, there is a collection, two collections, in fact, one for the pantry food bank here in Pontardawe, and then a shoebox appeal for Blythewood. If you would like to donate to the pantry food bank, please get in touch with me. The need is great in our area. And then if you'd like to find out more about Blythewood, do go to their website. Google search Blythewood shoebox appeal. So do pray for those wonderful charities as they seek to help those less fortunate than ours. But now we'll hand over to the Sandry family, and we'll hear the wonderful words of the deep, deep love of Jesus.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity we have to come together in prayer, whether that be in the church building or at home on YouTube. It gives us the opportunity to meditate on your greatness, your limitless love for us, and the ultimate sacrifice you made by sending your only son to die on a cross for us, his blood washing away our sins. These last few months have been trying, and we are weary. It's sometimes all too easy to lose focus on you, God. The busyness of life, the stresses of every day draw us away from the race we are all running. And sometimes it's also the easy thing to do, so we just seek your forgiveness, Lord. But we thank you for the faithfulness of your servant Stefan. We thank you for his leadership. We thank you for him shepherding us throughout these turbulent months. And we thank you for the protection you've given to him, his family, and the entire congregation here at Mount Elim, and we pray that that continues. On this Harvest Sunday, we remember those less fortunate than ourselves. Whether they be near to us here in Pontydawr, or far, wherever they may be across the world. We thank you for the food bank here in Pontydawr. We thank you for the men and women who generously give their time to provide this service, nourishing the needy. We also thank you for the work of Blythswood Care and Operation Christmas Child and other organisations providing shoeboxes to those who would otherwise would receive nothing this Christmas time. We thank you for their witness. We pray for their protection as they cross boundaries into war-torn areas. They cross boundaries into places that have been ravaged and continue to be ravaged by coronavirus. So we just lift them up to you now, Father God. Moreover, whilst we pray for the needy who receive our shoeboxes and receive our food parcels, we pray that they will be a blessing to them. We pray that they receive a greater gift. We pray that they receive the gift of a relationship with you. We pray that they are transformed by the Holy Spirit and recognise you as their personal saviour. We thank you for Tony, God. We thank you for his fellowship, his friendship, and his eagerness to learn all about you. We thank you for the work you've done in his life. And we rejoice, especially rejoice, with Tony today, the day of his baptism. We pray that he feels your presence in his life and that you will use him mightily to glorify your name here on earth. As we look forward to the week to come, we pray that we will constantly be reminded of your love for us. We pray that we remember you are a God who loves to spend time with us, a God who loves to hear our prayers, a God who loves us to read the Bible. And we just pray that we make time for you in the same way that you have limitless time for us, God, over the coming weeks. We ask this in your almighty name. Amen.
Well, the context for this year's harvest service is particularly unique and unusual. It's been such an unprecedented year, 2020. You might look back at the year and think, well, what reasons have I got to be thankful? Usually we come to harvest suppers and harvest services, and we can think of all God's goodness to us over the last year, and we can list his many blessings, and we come with joy in our hearts and thanksgiving on our lips. And yet many of us, I'm sure, look back at 2020 and we have very different feelings. Perhaps 2020 has been a year of isolation. You've been cut off from your loved ones, from your family members. Perhaps you're watching this online now because you are unable to go out. You can't leave the house. You are nervous. You're afraid. The COVID rates are increasing, and so you are shielding. And this is causing you to feel isolated and lonely. Perhaps there's been worry and anxiety. You've been concerned about loved ones. Maybe you've seen loved ones contract the virus, even succumb to it. Maybe you've grieved over the last few weeks and months. A loved one has died, has passed away. Or maybe a loved one died and you were not able to attend the funeral because of the lockdown measures. It's been such a difficult few weeks and months, hasn't it? And to think that we're not sure what's going to happen in the coming months adds to our worry and compounds the fear. We feel as if we haven't got any control over our lives anymore, whereas before we could plan things and we knew what would happen from day to day. Now we have no idea what will happen from month to month, and it changes all the time. And so you might look back at 2020 and think, well, what reasons have I got to be thankful? As I watch this harvest service today, I can't think of many reasons to thank God for 2020. It's been a miserable year. It's been a difficult year. And we can all sympathise. We can all empathise. We've all faced different trials and challenges we've had to overcome. And we've seen people who are close to us going through difficulties. And so 2020 has been a very difficult year. And so the context for this year's harvest service is very, very unusual. And yet, I want to remind you today that there are reasons to be thankful. That as we come and celebrate this harvest service, that God is good, that God is kind, and we can remember his many generous gifts to us. The first thing we need to remember is that God created this place in the first place. He created this world, this remarkable creation. The Bible teaches us in John chapter 1, in Colossians 1 and Hebrews 1, that all things were created by the Lord Jesus Christ. And they were created for him. He is the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the heir of all things. And Jesus created this remarkable universe. And it is his. He is the Lord of all things. He looks down on his creation and he made it. We know that this is a fallen creation. Because of the sinfulness of humanity, this is a world that is now under God's curse. And yet, even then, isn't it remarkable just how beautiful this world is? Maybe during the lockdown period, you discovered new parts of the world where you actually live. You've travelled far and wide, perhaps, where you've never really explored your own locality, and you've discovered new areas, discovered favourite spots. Well, I'm actually in one of my favourite new spots. I'm in the plantation in Glanrhyd. I can see the lake in front of me, the autumn colours around me. I've discovered Pontardawe Golf Course and the view over the Swansea Valley and towards Swansea and the Gower. Gellionen Mountain and the views from there. I'm sure we've all discovered our favourite new spots that we go and we feel peaceful and we feel that we can relax there, and we praise God for the beauty of the world around us, and that we are living in such a beautiful part of the world. And he provides for us. We have food to eat. We have water to drink. We are taking a collection today for the food bank. We can give thanks to God for the food that we have. And also we can thank God for the people who are behind the food bank. You might be watching this and perhaps you are struggling financially yourself. Perhaps you're not sure where the next meal will come from. Perhaps you are facing redundancy or unemployment and this is weighing down on you. Well, we're grateful to God for his common grace, that in his kindness that he has inspired people to start things like the food bank initiative. We thank God for charities. We thank God for the welfare state, that through these means God provides for us. And so whether it's through our gifts and talents that we're able to earn money, or perhaps there are difficulties. And so, yes, we are dependent on others, but we thank God for those people who use their gifts and use their energies to help and to bless us. And behind all of these acts of kindness is God himself, a God who inspires love because he's the God of love and who's created everyone in his image and gives common grace to all. And so we can give thanks to God for the food that we have, the water that we can drink, the clothes that we're able to wear. We praise God for the families that we have and the family members. you feel closer to them than you have for many, many years during this time of suffering. And it's true that absence makes the heart grow fonder. As you are isolated, you want to be with them, you want to see them. Where does such love come from? Where does such emotion, a desire to love people, to worry for them, to mourn after them? Where do these emotions come from? Well, they come from the fact that we've been created by a God who created us with an ability to love. And so we praise God for our families, our friends, the love that we experience. Even during COVID itself, perhaps you have drawn on the support of doctors and you've drawn on medical care and the medical technological advances. God created humanity with the ability to harness the energies and to harness the world around us, to cultivate it for our own good. And so the medical and the technological developments around us in themselves are reason to praise God. Do you see, I've only just listed some examples of God's goodness to us in the material, in the physical world. The fact that he's created this world in such a way that we can experience love, that we can receive love, that we can experience the love of others, and to see the technology of the world around us and to use this world for our benefit and for our good. And so can I encourage you to count your many blessings? Yes, you might have gone through difficulties. Yes, you are still aware of challenges and difficulties. But can I encourage you to write down the good gifts that you have received over the last few months? Those acts of kindness, those provisions that have helped you even through dark times. And there are spiritual blessings as well, which we will consider in the next video, in the next part of this video. But we're going to read a passage now from Luke chapter 17.
Today's reading is from Luke chapter 17, verses 11 to 19. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus travelled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go, your faith has made you well."
Thank you.
We've heard already today about the blessings of living in a world created by God. This is the fundamental doctrine, the most important teaching of all, that there is a God who is eternal and a God who created everything we see around us. There is no more significant teaching than this. This world didn't come from nothing. This world came because of God's grace and his love, his desire to create a people that he could know and have a relationship with. And we've heard Psalm 100, know that the Lord is God, it is he who made us. We've seen that he made us, and he created us as humanity in a remarkable way. We're told in Genesis 1 that we were made in his image. Humanity is unique in all of creation in that we have something which resembles God. We are made in his image. And so we're able to receive and give love because of this. Because despite the fallen nature of humanity, despite the wretched sin that we see in our heart and we see all around us, there is this capacity for love because we've been made in the image of God. And so we praise God for this, the common grace that allows people to show love to each other. And the fact that God shows common grace to everyone, he causes the sun to shine and the rain to fall on all, regardless of creed or belief or religion, regardless of goodness or wickedness. Every person receives the sun and the rain falls on them. God is good in a general sense to the whole of creation. And we've thought about this already and the need to give thanks to God for those general blessings in life. Now I want to move on and to consider healing. I can share about our experience as a family. Precious member of the family had a heart attack, and within a matter of days he'd been treated and he was out. He'd had a stent inserted and he was home and recovering well. It wasn't miraculous because it can be explained naturally, and yet we praise God and we thank God and we acknowledge that it was a wonderful act of kindness on God's behalf. Where did the medical technology come from, as we've mentioned already? And the swiftness of the treatment, how quickly it happened. We thank God for it. There are times when perhaps there's something which, again, you might not describe as miraculous, and yet the doctors might say we can't explain it. A patient has done a remarkable recovery, and they can't really explain how the medication has been so effective and so powerful, and we say, well, praise God. And there are those rare occasions when we have to acknowledge that there's been a miraculous healing and the doctors are utterly baffled, and we have to stand back and say there is no logical, natural explanation for this. This is a miracle. And this is what we see in Luke 17. There is miraculous healing here. Jesus is travelling along the border between Samaria and Galilee. And as he goes into a village, 10 men with leprosy come and meet him, and I'm sure you know just how horrific leprosy was. This terrible skin condition which ate away at the extremities, to lose fingers, to be then outcast in society, this disease which people were terrified of, and so people became outcasts. And so Jesus is met by these 10 lepers. And they cry out to Jesus, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. And Jesus tells them to go and to see the priests. And they go, they listen, they obey Jesus' words, and they are cleansed. They are healed miraculously, dramatically. And their leprosy is taken away from them. A physical healing. Now, it's significant in the Bible that skin condition is often a symbol of a deeper problem, a deeper disease, a deeper problem and condition, which is a problem of the sinful heart. Now, the Bible doesn't make the connection. The Bible doesn't say these people are lepers because they are worse sinners. No, it only uses this disease and this condition as a picture
because it's something which clings onto a person. It's something which is miserable. It's something which causes distress. It is something which you can't shake off and you want to get rid of it. You want it removed. And isn't sin like that when you become aware of the things you've said, the things you've thought, the things you've done, and you feel guilty because of it? The sorrow, the regret, you can't shake it off. King David said it felt as if his bones were wasting away when he became aware of some of the things he'd said and done. And so it's a suitable analogy. It's something which we can't shake off. It's something which causes a pain and an anguish. And it can cause us to be cut off as well. How many people have been cut off from families or even entire communities because of things they've said and done? A mess which has been the result of things they've said. And it certainly cuts us off from God himself, who cannot look at sin, who cannot look at anything which is not perfect or righteous, because he is holy. And so I want to consider this problem today, this disease, this condition known as sin. And I want to tell you today that Jesus can cleanse you, that he can purify you of all your sins. These lepers, they were transformed. They were healed. They were cleansed. The suffering which they had faced, the problems they had endured because of the leprosy. We don't know how long they had suffered. We don't know long how deep the suffering was. When was the last time they were embraced by a loved one? When was the last time they were in the midst of a group of people who loved them and cared for them? We don't know, but we know that from this day onwards, their lives would be transformed. And they would be healed. And this is what Jesus promises you and me. You see, Jesus came to this world to die on the cross for our sins. He took our sin and our shame and our guilt upon himself. We were facing the judgment and condemnation of God for the things that we've done. We were facing eternity of judgment. Not to know the peace of God, not to know the goodness of God, but to know the presence of God in judgment and in wrath. But Jesus came to this world to be the saviour of this world. And God the Father, in his grace and in his mercy, sent his Son, so that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And in this harvest service, when we give thanks to God for the creation around us and for the food that we're able to drink and the food we're able to eat and the water that we're able to drink, as we remember those who are less fortunate than us, those who will be receiving food through the food bank, or those who will be receiving gifts through Blythe's Wood Shoebox Appeal, as we remember these people, as we thank God for his kindness to us and pray for those who are without, let us fix our eyes on the greatest blessing and the greatest gift of all, which is the Lord Jesus coming to this world to give us forgiveness of sins. Now, the remarkable thing about this event here in Luke 17 is that only one of them actually thanked God for it. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. He was someone who was considered an enemy of the Jewish people. And Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except the Samaritan? Then he said to him, rise and go. Your faith has made you well. There's a tragic twist to this tale. It's because only one of them acknowledged the grace and kindness of God. 10 people were healed. 10 people were transformed. 10 people had their lives changed. Now they could go back and they could start families again, and they could start receiving money and earning money, and they could get jobs and enjoy this world once again. And yet only one of them gave thanks to God. Only one of them acknowledged that this had happened because of Jesus's compassion and grace. And so this is my final challenge today. We've heard about God's various kindnesses in creation, in humanity, and the love that we receive from others, ultimately in the love of God, in the Lord Jesus Christ, to know that we can have peace with God today, to know that we can have a relationship with God, that instead of judgment we can know God as our Father in heaven, that we can pray to him and know his guidance and his peace in our lives, and to know that we will not face judgment for eternity, but that we will be in heaven in Jesus' presence, the greatest gift of all. And so my question to you is this today: are you grateful? Are you thankful? Do you rejoice in your heart that there is such a good and faithful God? Have you confessed your sins? Have you placed your faith in the Lord Jesus? Do you praise him and worship him? Do you want to love him more and more? Do you want to show that love by obeying him and honouring and pleasing him with your life? Do you want to trust in him more and more? This person not only acknowledged that Jesus had healed him, but he came and spoke to Jesus. You can come to church and you can acknowledge God's goodness, but we can take it another step and we can speak to God himself and thank him in prayer for all that he's done. And so, yes, this has been a very, very difficult 2020 so far, and we don't know what the next few weeks and months will hold. We don't know the challenges ahead, but I want to remind you that there are so many reasons to be thankful. If you've trusted in the Lord Jesus today, you are blessed with every spiritual blessing from the heavenly realms. And so, can I encourage you to turn to the Lord Jesus, to go back to him, to praise him in a loud voice, and to throw yourself at Jesus' feet, and so you too will hear those words, "Rise and go, your faith has made you well." Have you received the greatest miracle of all? Forgiveness of sins, a relationship with God, everlasting life and glory. If you have, praise God and thank him this harvest for his good and faithful character and love.
thanks to the Lord, for his love endures forever. Give thanks. I hope and pray that you have been encouraged and inspired today to worship our God. If you'd like to find out more about this wonderful God and the good news of the gospel, read the Bible. Can I encourage you to go and to read the Gospels, perhaps Matthew, Mark, Luke and John. Get in touch with me or people here at Mount Elim. Listen to sermons. Come along to church if you can and know the goodness of God. So can I encourage you to delve further and to consider the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, the greatest gift of all. Let's pray. Listen to God in prayer. Our God and Father, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you for this creation around us. We thank you for the beauty of this area. Father, we know that there is much suffering at this time, and we pray for those who are going through difficulties right now, that they will know the comfort and the peace and grace of God. Might they turn to you and find rest. We thank you that you gave us your Son. As well as creating this remarkable world, you sent your Son to be the Saviour of this world, that everyone who might believe in him would not perish, but have eternal life. And so I pray now that everyone listening to this might turn to Lord Jesus, might find forgiveness and eternal, everlasting life and glory in the Lord Jesus. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all today and evermore. Amen.